The UNEP story has now reached a larger audience and it is picking up momentum. For those who didn't know, about a week ago, in the third week of September 2017, I made a video exposing the UNEP's institutional bias against nuclear energy. In it, I declared that there's a cordon sanitaire around nuclear energy and that therefore organizations that represent the civilian nuclear energy industry are barred from sponsoring a sustainable innovation forum organized alongside the 2017 climate summit in Bonn called COP23. I've already gone into the technical details as to why nuclear energy should be a part of the solution, and am planning to make many more videos trying to help you spread the message by providing well-reasoned and substantiated arguments. Do note that I do this out of my own accord. I've arrived in this form of advocacy by my own research. Nobody paid me to get to this point, and it took me many years. In fact, I really started learning more about nuclear energy after Fukushima happened more than 6 years ago. So let's see who is breaking the news and those who are supporting this message. First, we have Rod Adams, a former US Navy reactor engineer and now frequent contributor at Forbes, who wrote this article. And yes, I provided one of the quotes for it. UN Environmental Program tells nuclear industry its money isn't green enough. And this is one of the best titles so far. It hits the nail on the head. A link can be found in the description below. I'll quote one paragraph that basically gives us the true nature of the hypocrisy at hand here. Rod Adams writes, UNEP, an organization whose mission is to provide leadership and encourage partnership in caring for the environment by inspiring, informing, and enabling nations and peoples to improve their quality of life without compromising that of future generations, will not even take the nuclear industry's money and allow it to explain how its technology could contribute to an enhanced accomplishment of that mission. I can basically stop right here. This is the best sentence by far. But there's more. Next we get Paul Garvey at The Australian. He writes, UN accused of bias as energy forum excludes nuclear. We certainly weren't expecting UNEP to transform overnight or change its messaging or come out in support of nuclear energy. But we did want to make the outreach as part of a high-level environmental discussion, Mr. Hess told The Australian. Mr. Hess said nuclear energy was one of the few realistic solutions to the UN's competing goals of decarbonizing the world while also lifting more than a billion people out of energy poverty. How are you supposed to seriously address these really complicated problems when you completely ignore or even exclude a major low-carbon, low-land footprint energy technology from the equation? It just doesn't make sense. But this is what we see taking place, because a lot of these high-level policy bodies seem to be afraid of backlash. They seem to be afraid of the attention that would be generated by green groups. They need to be able to talk about this seriously. Nayan Chaba, a spokesperson for UNEP, said, "Our work on the nuclear sector is limited." And this ends the quote of The Australian. It begs the question, if your work on the nuclear sector is limited, and suppose that Hess would be incorrect in hypothesizing that you might be afraid of any backlash, why would you bar it from helping you expand on that work? Especially when those people can tell you a true success story with regards to deep decarbonization. Are they afraid that this will overshadow the flimsy success of renewables thus far? And before you jump on your typewriter to print a complete litany about how I am wrong, go through my video list first, because I've already made multiple videos in which I explain why this argument is wrong. It's the delusion on which the 100% renewable populism train rides. Let's be honest, we've just punched through 407 parts per million. The carbon levels in our atmosphere keep rising, and we're already well ahead of any remotely feasible decarbonization pathway. So by keeping nuclear energy from becoming a partner in the most important conversation of our age, the organizers of this event are basically complicit in making things worse. It's not only my opinion. This opinion is also held by world-leading scientists.
But that study of the climate system has very strongly led us to the conclusion that we are incurring unacceptable risk for a future generation. I think that's why we're all here. Solve the problem. Now, as Ken properly said, there are a lot of people who see this as an opportunity to advance one agenda or another. Okay, if we have to be conscious of that, it's not necessarily a bad thing. But why are four climate scientists who don't have strong backgrounds in nuclear physics here talking to you today about nuclear energy? It's because we're scientists and we can do the math, right? If we truly are sincere about solving this problem, unless a miracle occurs, we are going to have to ramp up nuclear energy very fast. That's the reality. That's not my ideology. I don't care whether it's nuclear, like my friend Ken said, we don't care whether it's nuclear or solar or hydro, whatever combination works.
Other notable people talking about this issue include, for instance, Kirsty Kogan from Energy for Humanity, fellow at Cornell University and author Mark Linus, energy researcher Ben Hurd, and Generation Atomics founder Eric Meyer. They can use your help in spreading the word, because if we create enough momentum and people all over this Congress start talking about this issue, it could potentially open a door for the World Nuclear Organization at a future event. I will provide links in the description. I cannot emphasize this enough. Nuclear has to be part of the discussion, and if people want to ignore it, it is our task to make sure they won't forget how misguided they are, and we may help them understand what needs to be done.